Center.
My name is Brooklyn.
And my name is Lacey.
We are happy you are here
on this beautiful Easter morning.
Hey Brooklyn, do you know what the Easter Bunny said about Lakeside Worship Center?
I don't know. What?
It's egg-cellent. It's the celebration of the resurrection of Jesus Christ.
It sure is. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
One more thing. Knock, knock.
Who's there?
Somebody.
Somebody who?
Somebody is ready for a great Easter service. Happy Easter!
Enjoy the service! Bye!
Good morning! He is risen, and he is risen indeed. Welcome to Lakeside Worship Center. We are so thankful and grateful that you have invited us to be a part of your Resurrection Sunday. God is good, and he's good all the time. We have a great service lined up for you this morning, but before we get into our worship, let's go to our sick and shut-in list. We have Jose. Let's pray for Jose. Jose has cancer, and we want to continue to pray for him and Brother Clayton. Let's pray for Brother Clayton. Also, I'd like for you to pray for First Lady and I will be going in for a surgery on April the 8th, and I won't be around for a couple weeks, but we have a great service lineup for you. Next week, we will have Pastor Timothy G. Taylor from Indianapolis, Indiana, my baby brother, from Tabernacle Missionary Baptist Church. He will be here with us, and he will be bringing a dynamic message. And for the next couple weeks, we have some great people lined up. I want to ask you to pray for Renee and I, because we claim my healing by in the name of Jesus. We claim it by our faith, trusting in him, that all things will be okay. And that's what we ask you to do. Trust God in all things. Hey, are you ready to worship? I am. I'm ready to give my worship on, because you know what? My Lord and my Savior, he got up. God bless you.
We serve an amazing God, and he's worthy to be praised. Amen. Amen.
Good.
Let's get our Bibles out. Let's turn to the 1 Corinthians in the 15th chapter. And we're going to look at the 20th through the 22nd verse. I'll give you a few seconds to get your device or your Bible out. And here's what that says. But Christ has indeed been raised from the dead, the first fruit of those who have fallen asleep. For since death came through a man, the resurrection of the dead comes also through a man. For as in Adam all die, so in Christ all will be made alive. May the Lord have a blessing to the reading of his word. Would you please bow your head with me as we go to the throne of mercy this morning? Oh, dear God, we come this morning and we lift you up in praise and glory. And you are truly worthy of our praise. We thank you this morning, Lord, that you allow me to stand here on Resurrection Sunday and preach your word. I am so thankful and I am so grateful. I pray, dear God, that your folks hear me and not see me. And please, oh Lord, I pray that you would clear my mind of all distractions. Things of the world that tries to draw me away from you. And I ask you, Lord, to please warm my heart with your love and your joy, your peace, and your forgiveness and your compassion. And fill my soul, dear God, with your Holy Spirit. As I stand in this room this morning, I ask you, Lord, to please hide me behind the old rugged cross. Oh, dear God, I pray that the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be accepted in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, let the church say, amen. Amen. We put a tag on the message this morning. It's a love thing. It's a love thing. He is risen, and he is risen indeed. The first fruit here in our text is the Israelites were to bring their first portion of their harvest to the priests as an offering to God. This was done in anticipation of the full harvest was to come, and as they trusted in that God was going to provide for them. Christ's resurrection is the promise that believers will one day be raised from the dead. You see, Adam disobeyed God and brought spiritual and physical death to the human race. But through the resurrection of Christ, the last Adam has made eternal life available to all. Now, as Jesus was being crucified, the soldiers mocked him. And they, by placing a crown of thorns on his head, by placing a sign above his head that, that read King of Jews. You see, they didn't believe that he was the true king. They did not believe that he was the King of Kings. They did not believe that he was the Prince of Peace. They did not believe he was the Lily of the Valley. They did not believe he was my rock and my wheel in the middle of a wheel. After Jesus' resurrection, he revealed himself to his disciples. And because he defeated death, he claimed all authority, all power over heaven and earth. Somebody say amen. It was Jesus' love for us that held him on the cross. Don't get it twisted now. They nailed him to the cross, but the nails didn't hold him to the cross. Those stakes wasn't holding him to the cross. What was holding him to the cross was his love for you and I. His love will reign in our lives when we put our faith, our hope, our trust in him. Somebody say amen. Because of the resurrection, we know what the cross is all about. It's a love thing. It's a love thing. Because of Easter, we understand the meaning of Good Friday. And I never could understand why we called it Good Friday. Good Friday, a day that I hate, but a day that I love. At the cross where Jesus died in our place for our sins, Jesus entered into our pain, our shame, and our guilt. Jesus came, let me tell you something. He came and took the weight of evil off our backs so that the chains could be broken. Not only that the chains could be broken, but the shackles that has got us bound down could fall off our feet. Don't miss your shot this morning, because I know some of us know what it means about having been shackled down or being chained down by sin. And because Jesus didn't stay in the grave, amen, somebody say amen, the death and resurrection of Jesus, let me tell you something, it's a love thing. It's a love thing. His love freeing us from our sin. His love overcoming death. His love making a way out of no way. Huh? It's a love thing. Because of the death and resurrection of Jesus, we see the love of God. When we look at Jesus, we can say, you have done enough. You have done enough. And if you don't do nothing else for me, you have done enough. You have done enough, because it's a love thing. It's a love thing. One of Jesus' boys had fallen short in a spectacular way. In fact, his failure was so dramatic, so epic, his story should have ended right there. Done. Done. And we're talking about Peter. We're talking about Peter. He wasn't just one of Jesus' followers. He was Jesus' boy. He was Jesus' right hand. And his sin was not just crossing of a line or a misunderstanding or my bad, I had a bad day. No, his sin was a flat out denial. And not what just once, not just twice, but three times. Three times he denied Jesus. Let me say something to you. If one of your friends would have done you like Peter done Jesus, you would just flat out just be done with them. You would unfriend them, you defriend them on your Facebook, take them off your Instagram, take them out of your contact list. You would be done with them. Have nothing else to do with them. You wouldn't answer no calls or nothing. You would be done with them. After the denial, Peter seemed to still be hanging out with the disciples. But I don't think the relationship or the fellowship was quite the same. And when Mary Magdalene brought the news that Jesus was alive, let me ask you this here. Have you ever wondered why Jesus chose a woman to bring that great news? Maybe because he wanted it done right. Amen. Amen. He sent a woman to bring the news. Now, Peter and John ran to the empty tomb. John got there first, but Peter followed. And I can imagine he followed very attentively behind. John seeing the grave clothes lying there, stained and soiled in the empty tomb. We don't know what Peter was thinking. John doesn't say. Jesus appears to Mary, calling her by name, Mary. I don't know if he had to call her two times, Mary. He had to call her the third time, Mary. I don't know. Then Jesus appears to the disciples, passing through a locked door, as if that wasn't enough. But wait a minute, Thomas was there, but they gave him a nickname. They used to call him Doubting Thomas. And Thomas says, hey, I want to see you, Jesus. I want to see the wounds. I want to see where the nails went in your wrist. I want to see it in your feet. And Jesus showed him that. And was Peter in the room with the disciples? John doesn't say. He doesn't say. But then in the next chapter, John gives a long, long account of encounter with Peter and in the risen Jesus. Now get your Bibles and turn to John, the 21st chapter and the 3rd verse. Here's what it says. I'm going out to fish, Simon Peter told them. And they said, we'll go with you. So they went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Now, Peter seems to still be in fellowship with the disciples. He announced that he's going fishing, and they said, we'll go with you. Now, I wonder, were they trying to encourage their dejected friend? Were they trying to keep him company in the midst of his shame, in the middle of his guilt? Were they trying to make him feel good about himself? How could Peter recover from this? How could Peter recover from denying Jesus? Peter was supposed to be the leader. He had walked on water. He had confessed Jesus as the Messiah. Now he had denied him. How could he regain his credibility with his friends? Because if he had done Jesus like that, oh, wait a minute. Can I trust him? If he had denied Jesus, what kind of credibility would he have with me or with any of his friends? And I doubt if he had any at all. You see, this is what shame does. Shame isolates us. It tells us that we're the only one. It says that your sin is uniquely disqualifying you, that no one else has ever done anything so bad as you have done, and you're just a terrible person. It makes the exemption of the worst way. We're the only person. We are the only person that had ever sinned so bad. And we can't be forgiven. We can't be forgiven. We've done the one thing that just sets us apart from every other sin. And it's past the point of return. It's past the point of return. We've fallen short. We're falling short. Our guilt and our shame tells us that it's game over. That I'm done. Sin is the dead end. But the Bible puts it like this here in the book of Romans in the 6th chapter and the 23rd verse. For the wages of sin is death. Jesus shows up that day in the middle of Peter's fishing trip. It's a love thing, folks. It's a love thing. In the middle of that trip, here comes Jesus. Turn your Bibles to John, the 21st chapter, and the 4th through the 7th verse. Now listen to this. Early in the morning, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples did not realize that it was Jesus. He called out to them, friends, haven't you any fish? No, they answered. He said, throw your net on the right side of the boat, you will find some. When they did, they were unable to haul in the nets because of the large number of fish. Then the disciples whom Jesus loved said to Peter, it's the Lord. It's the Lord. As soon as Simon Peter heard him say, it's the Lord, he wrapped his outer garment around him and he had taken it off and jumped into the water. Jumped into the water and rushed to Jesus. Let me tell you something. Jesus meets Peter where he's at. Peter tries to retreat to his old familiar place, to his comfort zone, and Jesus meets him right there. It's all about love, folks. It's all about love. I don't know what addictions that you have. I don't know what's got you bound. I don't know what bottom of what whiskey bottle that you are drowning in. I don't know what pill bottle that you're turning up. I don't know what injection that you're putting in your arm. I don't know what kind of cocaine you're putting up in your nose. I don't know what addiction you have. Is it overeating? Is it overspending? I don't know, cheating on your wife, cheating on your... I don't know what it is. I don't know what it is. I don't know what got you chained and shackled. But I tell you what, Jesus will meet you right there. The resurrection changed everything. It changed the way Jesus called Peter. When Jesus first called Peter, it was about a purpose. Follow me and I'll make you fisher of men. This time it's about a person. Peter, do you love me? Peter, do you love me? It's a love thing, folks. It's a love thing. When we retreat in shame, when we retreat in guilt, Jesus comes after us again and again. Jesus will track you down. Because it's all about love. Folks, it's a love thing. It's a love thing. His love will never stop chasing us. His love will never let us go. His love can change everything. What Jesus did for Peter, Jesus wants to do for you right now. He wants to do for you right now. In fact, before he found Peter, he spoke to him. He had appeared to the disciples. They were locked in a room, afraid and confused, wondering if Jesus really had been raised from the dead, and if so, what that meant for them. Go to your Bible in the book of John, in the 20th chapter, the 19th to the 23rd verse. Listen to this. On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." And when he said this, he showed them his hands and his hands. The disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father sent me, even so I am sending you." And when he said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone his sins, they are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." The resurrection. The resurrection changed everything. No more fear. No more shame. No more guilt. No more drama. Because of the resurrection, our sins can be forgiven. Our sins, our mess, our junk, missing the mark, my bad, my falling short, my transgressions, my crossing the line, are forgiven because Jesus hung on the cross. Somebody needs to shout this morning. Because Jesus died, somebody need to give him the glory this morning. Because Jesus rose again, somebody need to shout hallelujah this morning. Hey, I am forgiven. The resurrection has changed everything. And the power of sin that kept me bound, kept me shackled, kept me chained is broken. I am free. I am free. It's a love thing, folks. To be forgiven is to be set free. It's to be set free. Free from my guilt. Free from my shame. Free from the power that has enslaved me. I am free. I am free. I am free. It's about love. His wisdom, his love have set me free. Listen to this. Peter's life changed the day that day, and he started the movement that's called the church. Preached boldly, and he suffered greatly. He shepherded a flock of believers and taught them what it means to be forgiven and set free. A deep love for Jesus anchored him through even through the most difficult times of the days of his life, because it's a love thing. It's all about love. Family, your life can change right now today. If you're listening to me this morning, right now, your life can change right now. If you're watching this morning, regardless of what you have ever done in your life, it's not over. Your sin is not that great that you cannot be forgiven. I got some good news for you today. It's not over. Just as it wasn't over when Jesus died on that cross and was buried, it's not over for you. Let me tell you something. The best is yet to come. Because Jesus carried our sins on his back on that cross. Because God raised from the dead in victory over death and sin. It's not over. It's not over. Sin is not the end. You see, Satan called a party on Friday night and said it was all well and done. But he failed to realize that the battle had just begun. They beat my Jesus all night long, but it's not over. He hung there on that cross. They nailed him to the cross. But it's Friday, but Sunday's coming. They speared him in his side. It's Friday, but Sunday coming. They put a crown of thorns on his forehead. It's Friday, but Sunday's coming. He hung there. They laid him down in the tomb for 3 days. But let me tell you something. My God, your Lord, your Savior, he got up. Early on Sunday morning, he got up. He got up early on Sunday morning. The chains have been broken. The shackles have been taken off my feet. Early on Sunday morning, the shackles came off. Yes, the cross didn't hold him. Yes, he got up. Yes, the grave couldn't hold him. Yes, he got up. He got up. And he declared all victory and all power. He got up. He got up. And I got my salvation because he got up. I got my healing. I got my forgiveness because he got up. The resurrection changed everything. Just like Jesus come after Peter, he'll come after you. He'll never let you go. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, it's a love thing. It's a love thing. Today is the day. And today is your day that you can change your life. And all you got to do is reach for the hem of his garment. Your life can be changed. It can change. You do not have to continue to let your sins, your transgressions, keep you shackled and keep you bound. The chains can be broken. He got up. God bless you.
What time is it? It's church time, y'all.
We got it.
The battle had just begun.
Thank you for letting me part of your spiritual journey this morning. And remember this here, folks. He got up. And because he got up, because of the resurrection, your shame, your guilt, your transgressions, no longer have you shackled or chained. The chains has been broken. We would also like to thank those that have continued to support us financially with your tithes and offering. And if you would like to help us help others, go to www.lakesideworshipcenter.org, go to the menu button, go down to giving, and you can help us with your tithes and offering to help others. Remember this year, when praises go up, blessings come down. We see you next week. God bless you.